गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। टुडेज टॉपिक इज साइटोलॉजी ऑफ द फोकल लिवर लेशन। सो अबाउट द इंट्रोडक्शन, लिवर इज द मोस्ट कॉमनली एस्पिरेटेड ऑर्गन एंड अबाउट 55% ऑफ द एस्पिरेट फ्रॉम द एब्डोमेन आर फ्रॉम द लिवर। सो द मोस्ट कॉमन लेशंस व्हाई वी डू FNAC इज दैट इट मे बी ईदर अ डिफ्यूज पैरेन्काइमल लेशंस और स्पेस ऑक्यूपाइंग लेशंस in the liver, but FNAC is restricted only to the space occupying lesions because it is not of much value in the diffuse parenchymal lesions. So what are the sampling techniques for the FNAC procedure? The procedure can be done either USG guided through percutaneous, transjugular or endoscopic ultrasound guided ways, or it can be done through CT guided techniques. So the imaging will help in selecting an entry site so that we can obtain an optimum angle and depth to reach the target lesion. So we choose the shortest distance between the skin and the target lesion to do the procedure. We have to avoid the costophrenic angle so that we can prevent the pneumothorax, and also we should avoid the major vessels like the aorta, vena cava and the portal veins. And also while imaging, whichever respiratory phase the lesion is prominently available, the patient should be maintained in that same phase, and the appropriate position like the supine or the left lateral position according to the lesion can be maintained. So we use an 18 to 22 gauge needle known as the Shiba needle with a stylet for the procedure. And while doing the FNAC, the suction should be released finally before withdrawing the needle or the syringe outside. And for the biopsy procedure, an 18 gauge biopsy gun can be used. And while doing the biopsy itself, the touch print or the residual debris can be used for the cytological evaluation. In certain situations, it may be of value for examining the cytology even during the biopsy procedure. So the advantages of FNAC is that it is a cost effective procedure and it is time efficient. It can provide diagnosis and also staging in certain advanced cases, and also rapid on-site evaluation can be done. The material can also be used for microbiological cultures, flow cytometry, cytogenetics or molecular studies. So the common staining we use are the HME, DiffQuick, Papniclo stains, or the LBC can be done. What are the indications for the FNAC in the liver lesion? So it may be either a non-neoplastic or neoplastic. Under non-neoplastic, we have the infectious lesions, which include the hydatid cyst, the pyogenic abscess, the bacterial or the amoebic abscesses. And then we have the hepatic cyst, which may be the congenital. And the neoplastic may include the adenoma. These are the benign lesions, the adenomas of the bile duct or the liver cell adenoma, focal nodular hyperplasia or the hemangiomas. Under malignant tumors, we have the primary tumors and the secondary tumors, which is the metastatic tumors. The primary is the most common hepatocellular carcinoma, or in pediatric age group, it can be the hepatoblastoma, cholangiocarcinoma, or some rare primary tumors. Among the metastatic, we have the carcinomatous and the sarcomatous lesions. The most common will be the carcinomatous lesions. What are the contraindications and complications of doing the FNAC procedure? So the patient may have a vasovagal reaction or pain, sometimes hemorrhage, or if the patient is having a bleeding disorder, profuse bleeding can happen, which can be even fatal, or bile peritonitis can happen following the procedure. In case of metastatic tumors or malignancy, seeding of the primary and the metastatic malignant tumors, there is a chance of the seeding. And finally, rarely infection can happen. So going on to the cytology. In normal liver, what is the cytology we expect? So we can see the hepatocytes, the endothelial cells, the Kupffer cells, and the bile ducts, bile ductular epithelial cells. So hepatocytes, the hepatocytes are singly or loosely cohesive groups of large flat polygonal cells with dense granular cytoplasm, and fraying will be present at the edges. Depending on the age, the lipofuscin granules can be present. Mostly, even the normal cells will have variable size. It can have even binucleate cells at times. But the nucleus will be regular, centrally placed, and will have a moderately granular chromatin and small nucleoli. Intranucleus cytoplasmic inclusions can be seen even in a normal liver or during the reactive change. Then in between the hepatocytes, we can see narrow clear spaces, which are nothing but the intercellular bile canaliculi. And then we have the Kupffer cells, which are not commonly seen in the cytology. Next, the bile duct epithelium. The bile duct epithelium will be flat, cohesive clusters with distinct cell borders and honeycombic canthi present. And they may be either the small ductular cells or the large ductular cells. The small ductular cells may be cuboidal, and the large ductular cells are the columnar cells. The nucleus will be uniform, ovoid, and will be basally placed. The bile duct epithelium normally can be present in a smear or can even be absent. But when it is present predominantly in this slide, it can be either a bile duct adenoma or a hamartoma. When it is absent, we have to suspect a liver cell adenoma or a hepatocellular carcinoma. Next are the mesothelial cells. So while doing the procedure, we have to penetrate the Glisson's capsule to enter the liver. The Glisson's capsule has the mesothelial cells. So during the procedure, if these cells are obtained, we can see them as sheets or windows of oval or spherical cells with granular nuclei and multiple nucleoli. Because of the prominent nucleoli, we should not mistake them for malignant cells. So this is the normal histology of the liver, where we have the portal vein, hepatic artery, and the bile duct. This is the portal triad, and this is the central vein. So in cytology, this is how we see the hepatocytes with large polygonal cells, abundant pink granular cytoplasm. Sometimes even binucleate cells can be present, and the edges will be frayed. Whereas the bile duct epithelial cells are arranged compactly with small nucleus, basally placed nucleus. These are the sheets of the mesothelial cells with prominent nucleoli. Next are the pigments. So normally we can see the lipofuscin pigments in the hepatocytes. They are located perinuclear, and they are fine, non-refractile, brown to golden brown granules. The abnormal pigments can be, sometimes the bile can be seen in the cytoplasm in case of hepatitis or obstructive jaundice, or even in case of malignancy, hepatocellular carcinoma, the hepatocytes might have the bile pigments. So these are greenish brown pigments, and the hemosiderin are coarse golden brown refractile pigments, which will be present in the cytoplasm in case of iron overload in conditions like hemochromatosis or hemosiderosis. Then melanin pigment is a brown pigment which can be present in melanoma. And copper can be seen as coarse green or brown pigments, which is seen in the Wilson's disease, Indian childhood cirrhosis, or primary biliary cirrhosis. So these are the lipofuscin pigments, which is normally present in the hepatocytes. These are the bile pigments, which can normally be present in the canaliculi. But when it is present in the cytoplasm, we have to suspect the pathology. And these are the iron pigments. And this is the Prussian blue stain to demonstrate the iron pigments, hemosiderin. So what is the approach to the cytology of a liver lesion? So broadly, the liver lesions can be classified as surgical and medical. In case of medical, we need to study the tissues properly so that we can grade the inflammation, arrive at a diagnosis, stage the fibrosis. So for this, we will be needing a whole tissue from the core biopsy. So FNAC does not play a major role in the medical diseases. So mainly it is concentrated to the surgical diseases. So it can be primary or secondary lesions. So secondary lesions in case of metastasis, depending on the stage of the disease, we can decide upon the procedure. In primary diseases, we have the hepatocellular carcinoma, cholangiocarcinoma, and the mixed carcinoma. So in the hepatocellular lesions, we can have the abnormal hepatocytes, so the degenerative, regenerative, and dysplastic cells, which may lead on to cirrhosis, And then we have the focal nodular hyperplasia, adenoma, and the hepatocellular carcinoma. In cholangiocarcinoma, the carcinoma may arise from either the large duct or from the small ductules. So the procedure can be done either percutaneously, transjugular, or endoscopic ultrasound. As I mentioned, there is no role for FNAC in the medical liver disease. So for cytology, there is no particular adequacy, no standard criterion to say the adequacy of the liver lesions. So finally, to arrive at a diagnosis, when there is the availability of FNAC and core biopsy, both should be done. Both should be reported by a single pathologist so that the findings can be correlated. In case it is reported by more than one pathologist, close communication should be available between the two of them. So moving on to the lesions. So first we are going to see about the cystic lesions. So we have the congenital hepatic cyst. So it is nothing but a cyst which contains a clear or a straw colored fluid. So on FNAC we can see macrophages which may be small or large in size. And these are the bile duct epithelial cells which can be seen sometimes during the procedure. Next is the hepatic foregut cyst. This is lined by the ciliated columnar epithelium. So here we can appreciate the columnar cells with the cilia. On histology, this will be appearing like a pseudostratified epithelium. We have the pyogenic abscess, which can be either due to the bacteria. The bacterial abscess can be caused by the ascending cholangitis, septicemia, appendicitis, subphrenic abscesses, trauma. The abscesses can be either a single lesion or sometimes it can be even multiple, and sometimes bile stain pus can be obtained. So on FNAC we can see intact and fragmented polymorphonuclear leukocytes, and also here we can see the reactive hepatocytes along the neutrophils. The amoebic abscess can be seen. So amoebic abscess is caused by the Entamoeba histolytica. The trophozoites containing ingested erythrocytes can be seen on the smear. So in the abscess, due to the necrosis, a brown color liquid, which is referred to as the anchovy pus sauce, can be obtained. So in amoebiasis, we have the on ingestion of the mature cyst, the cyst can travel to the liver, and after exudation, the lesion can happen. So this is the FNAC where we can see the trophozoites, which are which are cells with small eccentric nucleus and cytoplasmic vacuoles containing the RBCs. Next, the hydatid cyst can happen, which is caused by the Echinococcus granulosus, also called as the dog tapeworm larvae. It is a uniocular hydatid cyst, but also it can have the septations, and it is most commonly in the right lobe. The wall of the cyst has a thin germinal layer, and attaching to it can be the daughter cyst, which is otherwise called as the brood capsule. So these have the head scoliosis and the hooklet. The hydatid sand is nothing but the degenerative scoliosis and the debris which are found in the cyst. So we have to be careful during the procedure because the spillage can cause anaphylactic shock. So in Echinococcus granulosus, on ingestion of the eggs, the oncospheres enter the intestine, and then the oncospheres move to the liver to cause the hydatid cyst. This is the FNAC picture where we can see a scolex with the hooklets. This is the histology picture where we can see the multiple cyst with the protoscoliosis. This is a single hooklet which can be seen as a refractile structure on lowering the diaphragm during examination. Next is the hemangioma. Hemangioma is a very commonly found incidental liver lesion. It is a benign lesion. It is asymptomatic, and it is a well circumscribed space occupying lesion. In case of cavernous hemangiomas, they may be very large and sometimes may cause pressure symptoms. FNAC is not recommended in hemangiomas commonly because it may lead on to uncontrolled hemorrhage. So on cytology, we can see mostly blood with a fibrovascular connective tissue and benign liver cells. So these are the hemorrhage with the spindle cells. So we cannot definitively tell on FNAC with the hemangioma. The spindle cells with the fibrovascular connective tissue and the hemorrhage can be seen. Next are the neoplastic cysts. So the neoplastic cyst is very rare. It can be a hepatic biliary cystadenoma and cystadenocarcinoma. It is lined by the cuboidal or the columnar mucinous epithelium, and dysplastic changes can be seen. And the cyst can also occur as a secondary change in the solid tumors like the hepatocellular carcinoma or the carcinoid tumors of the liver. So this is a neoplastic cyst with the mucus in the background and a monolayered sheath of the benign cells which is appearing in the cytology. But whereas in the histology, we can see the hyperplastic papillae with the dysplastic changes. Next, that is about the cystic lesions. Next, moving on to the solid lesions. First about the focal nodular hyperplasia. Focal nodular hyperplasia is encapsulated and mostly it will be seen in the periphery. It occurs in both the sexes in all the ages. It may be either single or multiple. On CT, we can see a central stellate scar. On histology, central areas of fibrosis, malformed arterial vessels and bile ducts can be seen. Kupffer cells and eosinophilic hyaline inclusions can be seen. So in cytology, there is only a limited findings in cytology. Normal hepatocytes can be found and the bile ductal cells forming long tubules can be seen. So this is the focal nodular hyperplasia with the benign cells and there is no ATPA in these cells. We can see that the nuclear cytoplasmic ratio is maintained. These are the benign hepatocytes and these are the benign ductal cells. Next is the liver cell adenoma. Liver cell adenoma is also an encapsulated neoplasm. It commonly occurs in young women with contraceptive conception. So it is seen as a poorly organized liver parenchyma cells with hepatocytes of variable sizes. Portal spaces and bile ducts are absent in this lesion. So dysplasia may occur. And in cytology, we can see abundant benign hepatocytes and three-dimensional cohesive clusters. But the nuclear membranes will be smooth and the NC ratio will be maintained. But the duct, bile duct epithelium will be absent. So this is a liver cell adenoma where there are interconnecting nests and cords of relatively small uniform hepatocytes. And there is on the high power, we can see there is absence of nuclear ATPA. There is no prominent nucleoli and the nuclear cytoplasmic ratio is maintained. So on histology also, we can see that the cells are maintained the nuclear cytoplasmic ratio. Next, moving on to the malignant lesions. So the most common primary lesion is the hepatocellular carcinoma, which accounts for 80% of the primary malignant tumors. So the it can be in the background of hepatitis B or C infection, or aflatoxin consumption can be a risk factor. Clonorchis sinensis infection can also be a risk factor. The underlying cirrhosis can be either due to secondary to alcoholism, chronic viral hepatitis B or C. So most commonly, it can be seen as a right upper quadrant mass. The patient may present as abdominal pain, weight loss and ascites. It can be a single large mass or sometimes it can even be multiple smaller nodules. Elevated serum alpha fetoprotein is an important finding. So on the histology, we have the different patterns. The trabecular, sinusoidal or plate-like pattern is the most common type. Then we have the solid pattern, pseudoglandular or the acinar pattern, fibrolamellar, clear cell variant and pleomorphic giant cell pattern. So this is a hepatocellular carcinoma gross picture where we can see various areas of hemorrhage and necrosis. Here we can see that there are neoplastic cells with it is difficult to differentiate from the normal hepatocytes, but here some cells we can see that they have increased nuclear cytoplasmic ratio. And one more important finding is the naked nuclei, that is a nuclei without cytoplasm. You can see that the naked nuclei are crowding over here. And an important finding is the slender endothelial cells and absence of bile duct cells. So in well-differentiated hepatocellular carcinoma, it is very difficult to identify on cytology. We can see clusters of hepatocytes of various sizes surrounded by an outer layer of endothelial cells or capillaries. Naked nuclei will be present. Large nucleoli will be present. Absence of bile duct cells and bile can be present in the cytoplasm. So this is another picture of well-differentiated hepatocellular carcinoma, where we can see that they resemble almost the benign hepatocyte, but some cell we can see has the increased nucleocytoplasmic ratio, and also naked nuclei can be present. So here we can appreciate the naked nuclei very well. This is a trabecular pattern of the hepatocellular carcinoma, where it is lined by the endothelial cells or the capillaries. This is another picture of the trabecular pattern of the hepatocellular carcinoma, where we can see the clusters of hepatocytes with a sharply demarcated surface lined by the endothelial cells. This is the hyperview. We can see the endothelial cells lining the tumor cells. This is the HNE picture of the trabecular hepatocellular carcinoma. Next is the clear cell hepatocellular carcinoma. Here we have the cells are appearing clear because the cytoplasm will be very fragile and will be lost during the process. We can appreciate very well the prominent nucleoli that is present over here. And we can see mild pink granules, granular cytoplasm in these cells. Next is the solid pattern hepatocellular carcinoma. Here we are able to appreciate there are a prominent intranuclear inclusions in these nuclei, and we can see the cells have increased nucleocytoplasmic ratio. Naked nuclei are seen, and the crowding of the nuclei is also seen. Next is the pseudoglandular or the acinar pattern. Here you can see that the tumor cells are attempting to form an acinar or a glandular pattern, and we can appreciate the bile in the acinar pattern of these cells. So this is a HNE picture where we can see the bile being formed. So next is the fibrolamellar hepatocellular carcinoma. In fibrolamellar hepatocellular carcinoma, we can see clusters of large polygonal cells, and they are connective tissue, strands of connective tissue will be present. These cells are pleomorphic. We can appreciate the pleomorphism with abundant pink granular cytoplasm, and prominent nucleoli will be present. Here we can see the at the 12 o'clock position, this is the tail body, and this is the eosinophilic hyaline globule that can be seen in the fibrolamellar region. One important finding here is that the background cirrhosis can be absent in the fibrolamellar hepatocellular carcinoma. Next is the pleomorphic giant cell variant of the hepatocellular carcinoma, where we can see the multinucleated giant cells. These are osteoclast-like multinucleated giant cells with the background of the tumor cells. This is the HNE picture to show the pleomorphic multinucleated giant cells. Next, the poorly differentiated hepatocellular carcinoma. Here we can see that we cannot say that the hepatocytes are these are poorly differentiated, so we cannot make out these are of hepatocyte origin. And the HNE picture also we can appreciate that it is looking like a high grade tumor. So to summarize, in very well differentiated hepatocellular carcinoma, the tumor cells closely resemble the benign hepatocytes with altered NC ratio and prominent nucleoli. In the trabecular pattern, the malignant cells will be surrounded by a layer of endothelial cells. In clear cell hepatocellular carcinoma, we can see that the cytoplasm will be Next, the glandular pattern. You can see that glandular pattern, they can mimic the adenocarcinoma at night. The fibrolamellar pattern, they can see the cells have abundant pink cytoplasm with pale bodies and hyaline globules. And pleomorphic giant cell hepatocellular carcinoma, we saw the multinucleated giant cells. Next, moving on to the intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. So the Caroli's disease, the primary sclerosing cholangitis, and then chronic IBD, thorotrast, all are precursor lesions for the intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. In these conditions, chronic bile stasis can happen. It can be either a single large mass or it can be multiple nodules. So in histology, mucus producing adenocarcinoma with densely fibrotic stroma will be present. The patterns can be trabecular, solid, mucinous, signet ring cell, adenosquamous, mucoepidermoid or sarcomatoid. On cytology, however, we can see clusters of cuboidal or columnar cells forming acini papillae in a clear background, and prominent nuclei can be appreciated. So this is a gross picture where we can see the satellite nodules. This is a HNE picture where we can see the adenocarcinoma pattern. And here in cytology, we can see the cells with the increased nuclear cytoplasmic ratio trying to form the acini or the glandular pattern. So bile duct adenoma versus the intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. In bile duct adenoma, here we can see the clusters of benign bile duct epithelial cells in a clean background. On high power, we can see that even though the cells are crowded, they still retain the polarity. Whereas here we can compare the benign cells with the malignant cells. Here the cells are still maintaining the polarity and the ANC ratio is maintained. Whereas here we can appreciate that the loss of the polarity and increased ANC ratio. And similarly, in the HND picture, here we can see this is the malignant portion, whereas this is the benign ductal area. So there can be a combined hepatocellular carcinoma and cholangiocarcinoma. In cytology, here we can see these are resembling the hepatocellular carcinoma with a pink granular cytoplasm, a prominent intranuclear inclusion and decreased ratio. Whereas in cholangiocarcinoma, we can see that the acinar pattern with the resembling the bile duct epithelial cells. In HNE also, these were the lesions which were found adjacent. This resembles hepatocellular carcinoma, whereas an adjacent portion had a cholangiocarcinoma. So, how to differentiate between the hepatocellular carcinoma and the metastatic adenocarcinoma with the help of the IHC? The hepatocyte antigens, carcinoembryonic antigen, AFP, alpha 1 antitrypsin, cytokeratin 8 and 18 all will be positive in the hepatocellular carcinoma, whereas it will be negative in the metastatic adenocarcinoma. And then the cytokeratin 7 and 19 epithelial membrane antigen, DEREP4, CA99 human epithelial related antigen, all will be positive in the metastatic adenocarcinoma. Next, hepatoblastoma. It is the most common primary malignant tumor of the liver under 5 years of age, and males are more affected than the females. So an elevated AFP will be present. On histology, the epithelial and the mesenchymal components can be present. The epithelial component may be either fetal or embryonal. Sometimes an anaplastic component can be present, which may resemble the small round cells, and extramedullary hematopoiesis can also be present. On cytology, we can see that the epithelial and the mesenchymal components, the tumor cells are arranged in three-dimensional clusters, loose sheets, cords, in rosette pattern or pseudopapillae. The fetal cells, if it resembles a fetal type, it may be similar to the well-differentiated hepatocellular carcinoma, but the cells are smaller and more uniformly dispersed and has a high ANC ratio. Whereas if it resembles the embryonal type, the cells may be small, poorly differentiated and spindled in appearance. Anaplastic type will have small round blue cell tumors. Sometimes the metaplastic elements like bone, cartilage, muscle may also be present, and the extramedullary hematopoiesis can be present, which can be appreciated with the presence of megakaryocytes in cell culture. So here we have the clusters of cohesive groups of cells. This is the epithelial component where they resemble the hepatocellular carcinoma with the pink granular cytoplasm. But still the cells are smaller than the hepatocytes and they are more uniformly dispersed with the increased nucleocytoplasm ratio. And this is the fetal type. If it is the embryonal type, it will have the spindled cells. Next is the primary carcinoid tumor in the liver. So the carcinoid tumor can be seen in the liver. So to arrive at a diagnosis, we have to rule out all other carcinoids to say that it is a primary from the liver. Here we can see that the cells are uniform small cells with a scant eosinophilic cytoplasm and small gland-like. They are trying to form small gland-like structures. The cells are well preserved in a cohesive group without any nuclear molding or any single cell necrosis. Here we can see the cells are arranged around a blood vessel, capillary. This is a primary carcinoid, whereas this is a metastatic carcinoid in the liver from the ileum. Here we can see that the cells are more hyperchromatic and necrosis can also be present in this metastatic carcinoma. So for the space occupying lesions, the cytology and the possible diagnosis. So normal hepatocytes in this liver, when we see normal hepatocytes, scanty bile duct epithelium and scanty fibrous stroma, can be either a normal liver, a focal nodular hyperplasia, or a cirrhotic nodule. Whereas when the hepatocytes are normal, strings of endothelium are seen and no bile duct is present, then it can be either a well-differentiated hepatocellular carcinoma or a liver cell adenoma. We cannot say it in cytology. We have to differentiate it further. If the cells in the clusters or the trabeculae with smooth edges surrounded by the endothelial cells are seen in classic hepatocellular carcinoma. In less differentiated hepatocellular carcinoma, we can see polygonal cells with naked nuclei. Then if it is an adenocarcinoma pattern, we have to consider cholangiocarcinoma. If there are small cell malignant tumors, it can be either the pediatric blastomas or secondary deposit, or it can be a small cell carcinoma of the lung, pancreatic endocrine tumors, or it can be a lymphoma or the childhood tumors like neuroblastoma or hepatoblastoma. Then if the cells only, we obtain only blood on the smear, then we have to suspect hemangioma or angiosarcoma and look for the stromal components. If there is fluid, mucin or glandular cells, so then it can be either cyst adenoma or a ciliated foregut cyst. If there are histiocytes or bile duct epithelium, we can suspect the amoebic cyst. And then if there is a polymorphonuclear leukocytes, it can be an abscess. So moving on to the secondary deposits of the liver. So broadly, we can divide them into the small cell tumors depending on the morphology, large cell tumor, spindle cell, or a tumor with bizarre features. So the small cells can be either differentiated or undifferentiated, and the large cells can be most likely of epithelial origin. Carcinoma with glandular features, with squamous features, or with unique features. So if it is a spindle cell tumor or tumors with unusual features. So we'll be seeing how to approach each one of them. The most common secondaries that are found in the liver is the lung, colon, followed by the pancreas, breast, and the stomach. So most commonly, the secondary deposits will be multiple lesions in the liver. Sometimes even a single lesion can be seen. So for approaching the small cell tumors in the liver, with the cytological features, with the age of the patient, with the additional ancillary studies, so we can arrive at a diagnosis. So if we see cohesive clusters of small cells with nuclear molding, cell necrosis, and rosette formation, So, nuclear molding in cell necrosis in older patients with cytokeratin positive, we can say it is a small cell carcinoma. Whereas in infants and children, if the small cells are forming a rosette with the pink fibrillary material with neuroendocrine markers positive, we can suspect a neuroblastoma. And if there is a mixture of blastemic cells and the epithelial cells, the small cells in children, vimentin and keratin positive, then it is a Wilms' tumor, nephroblastoma, Wilms' tumor deposit in the liver. So if the cells are monotonous and with micronuclei and no cell molding in adolescents and young adults with CD99 and vimentin positive, it is a Ewing's sarcoma. If the cells are spindled in infants and children with vimentin desmin positive, it can be embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma or any retroperitoneal genital urinary or a head and neck carcinoma. So if there is a isolated or non-cohesive small cells with nuclear abnormalities, monotonous cell population, then with the LCA positive, we can say it is lymphoma. If the uniform round cells with salt and pepper chromatin in adults with neuroendocrine markers positive, it can be a carcinoid tumor, or if the other tumors are ruled out, it can be a primary in the liver. Next, about the large cells, we saw about the small cells. Now, for the large cells with the metastasis to the liver, so if there are predominantly columnar cells with the necrotic background, primarily we have to suspect the colon cancer in an elderly, or if there is a history of colon cancer, it's a colonic adenocarcinoma. Then, if there is a polygonal cells with high NC ratio arranged either in groups, chains, or single files, sometimes with mucin, it can be in adult female, it can be a breast carcinoma. The ERPR will be positive. And there are pleomorphic glandular cells or single cells with prominent nucleoli, it can be a lung carcinoma. It can be either adenocarcinoma or a large cell carcinoma. If we see signet ring cells in an adult male or a female with upper GI symptoms, it can be a gastric carcinoma. If there are clusters of cells with abundant mucinous cytoplasm in an elderly person with a mass in the gallbladder, it can be a gallbladder carcinoma or an intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. So next, pleomorphic cells with prominent nucleoli, we have to suspect melanoma. And if the with the prominent nucleoli and the melanin pigment present, we can suspect melanoma. If the cells are loosely and cohesively arranged with pink granular cytoplasm, and the adults have any history of ovary or breast cancer or stomach cancer, then we can go ahead with the IHCs and check for the alpha fetoprotein in the Hepar IHCs. And if after ruling out the things, we can see it is a metastatic gastric, ovarian, or breast carcinoma mimicking the hepatocellular carcinoma. So this is the metastatic colon adenocarcinoma, where we can see the columnar-like cells with a necrotic background. Sometimes it can even have the bile pigments, so we can wrongly diagnose it as a hepatocellular carcinoma. So this is a metastatic melanoma, where we can see the prominent brown melanin pigments in the cells. Whereas here, this is a different appearance of the melanoma with the cleaved nucleus. Here it is mimicking the thyroid carcinoma. So if the large cells have a squamoid feature, then we have, if it is a highly keratinizing pleomorphic tumor cells with necrosis and inflammation in an elderly person with a history of smoking, then we have to suspect metastasis from the lung, esophagus, head and neck tumors, or rarely it can be a bile duct carcinoma. If there is a single or pleomorphic cells with keratinization and a prominent nucleoli and rigid cytoplasm, then we can suspect a tumor from the squamous cell carcinoma lung, esophagus, or bladder. If it is usually non-keratinizing with a jagged outline, then we have to suspect in case of a female either from the gynecological or the urothelial origin. So for tumors with the spindle cell features, If there are fascicles with a cigar shaped nuclei and secret is positive, it is a gastrointestinal stromal tumor. If it has an epithelioid morphology with secret positive, it can be an epithelioid cyst. And if the tumor cells are single with elongated pleomorphic nucleus and keratin positive, HEPAR negative, it can be a metaplastic carcinoma of the kidney, lung, breast, or other organs. If the cells have a salt and pepper chromatin, it can be an atypical carcinoid of the lung or the pancreas. If there is pleomorphic cells with whorls of cells with bloody and necrotic background, it can be either with endothelial markers positive, primary angiosarcoma of the liver should be considered. So what are the limitations of the FNAC is that, as we saw, the parenchymal diffuse lesions like cirrhosis, biliary cirrhosis, chronic hepatitis, metabolic disorders, obstructive jaundice, and granulomatous disorders are difficult to diagnose in cytology. When we consider cirrhosis, the cells will be appearing pleomorphic, or they can have even intranuclear cytoplasmic inclusions, prominent nucleoli. So mostly this can be confused with the carcinoma. And also we have the granulomatous disorders. Sometimes in cytology, we can get a granuloma, but it is better to have the core biopsy for diagnosis of the granulomatous disorders. In case of metabolic disorders, we can see the cytoplasmic vacuolations in cytology or the inclusions. In obstructive jaundice, we can see the bile pigment in the hepatocyte cytoplasm. These disorders have FNAC has limited value in the these disorders. So here we have an interesting case of the liver lesion in the FNAC, diagnosed in the FNAC. So here the lesion had the microfilaria present, which was diagnosed in the cytology. Thank you. These are my references.
Very nice, Pavitra. Very nice. I think we can go to the questions. Dr. Bharti?
Yes, ma'am. Good presentation, Pavitra. We'll start with the questions.
Yeah. So, identify these cells.
Josephine, can you take this question? Or I'll go to the first here. Just been wait. First year's who are all there? Kavya.
Hello.
Kavya.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you identify, ma'am?
Ma'am, it's a normal hepatocyte, ma'am.
Can you describe that?
They are polygonal cells with abundant cytoplasm, ma'am. They'll be frayed at the edges.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. This is a normal hepatocyte. These are flat polygonal cells with abundant granular cytoplasm with fraying at the edges. Sometimes binding plated cells and prominent nucleoli can also be seen. Next question, ma'am. Identify this cytology.
Ulagarasi.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, Ulagarasi.
Ma'am, it is cataract cyst.
Yes, it's not clear.
Hello, ma'am. Hello, ma'am.
Yeah, tell. Lot of background disturbance. Or Prateep, can you tell?
Hello, ma'am. Hydatidosis, ma'am.
Is it hydatidosis? What do you call it? Hydatidosis. It is the diagnosis of hydatidosis. You will see this. But what has she wrong with? What is it called?
Ma'am, they are hooklets. Hooklets.
Hooklets. Okay. Don't tell hydatids is simply diagnosis. So hooklets of hydatidsis should be your answer. Okay. Yes. Okay. How do you identify this? She told no. Have you identified this in the FNAC spheres? Any precaution that you have to take? Ms. Pavitra, did you mention that?
Yes, ma'am.
What precaution?
It will be refractile. We have to lower the diaphragm and check for
that. And see, then it will be visualized better. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Next question.
Identified this question.
Okay. Kirtana?
Hello? Good morning, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yeah, go ahead.
Ma'am, epithelial cells, ma'am, uniform cells with increased nuclear cytoplasmic ratio, ma'am. Could it be hepatoblastoma, ma'am?
Hepatoblastoma,
ma'am.
Pavitra?
Yes, ma'am. It's a hepatoblastoma. This was the epithelial component with the cells resembling moderately differentiated hepatocellular carcinoma. But the difference is that these are more smaller, uniformly dispersed with the increased nuclear cytoplasmic ratio.
Okay, fine. Good.
Thank you, ma'am.
Suman?
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, Suman.
Yes, ma'am. So this is a hypercellular lesion where we can see clusters and singled out cells. Mm. And these cells have a high NC ratio with hyperchromatic nuclei, ma'am, and an abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm.
Mm.
And so this could be a hepatocellular carcinoma, well differentiated form.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. So they closely resemble the benign hepatocytes, but there will be altered NC ratio and absence of wild duct cells.
Yeah, that is more important. Okay. Good. Next question.
Yes, ma'am. Next question.
Ritika, can you take this? Ritika? She's not there.
Good morning, ma'am.
Yeah, good morning, Ritika.
Very good, Bharati. Very good discussion. And
last question, Ritika.
Whom did you call?
Ritika.
Ma'am, here we can see there are clusters of tumor cells, ma'am. They are large and round to polygonal in shape. And we can also see strands of connective tissue, ma'am, that is present here. And these cells have marked nuclear pleomorphism and prominent nucleoli. And we can also see hyaline globules, ma'am.
The arrow is pointing towards?
The hyaline globule, the eosinophilic body that we can see. So it is a fibrolamellar HCC.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Good. I think that's the last question, no?
Yes, ma'am. Last.
Yeah. It's open for all others. Ma'am?
Yeah. Thank you, Bharati. Very nice moderation. And thank you, Pavitra. Very, very extensive discussion. Just one thing I wanted to know. You said there is one specific, for hemangiomas, you don't do FNACs. Are there any other conditions where FNAC is contraindicated in liver lesions? Pavitra?
Yes, ma'am. If there is a massive ascites, it is difficult to do FNAC, ma'am.
Yeah,
so we have to try.
Okay. What about hydatidsis? Is it okay to do it, or do you have to take any particular precautions, Pavitra?
Ma'am, it is better to be avoided, ma'am. Mostly should be diagnosed with the imaging.
Yes.
By accident, if we do the FNAC, these are the findings.
Okay. Sure. Okay. Any other questions? I think this can ask. But good discussion and very nice pictures also. Good one.
Thank you.
If there is no questions,
thank you, sir.
Word of caution to everybody: careful in FNHCM, especially in thoracic liver. Okay, never diagnose them without radiological features.
Yes.
Because it is degenerating or regenerating hepatocytes will exactly look like things. So, ask for core biopsy. Even core biopsy is very difficult to differentiate. So we have to always correlate radiological. Thank you, Poitra.
Yes, sir.
Any other questions, any faculties? Okay, if there is no questions, well, I think we can wind the session. It's a thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Bharti. Thank you, Pavitra. Thank you.
Thank you.